Can touch my heart like you do. I can search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. Oh, your mercy flows like rivers so wide. Healing comes from your hands. Suffering children are safe in your arms. There is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I can search for all eternity long and find there is none. There is none. There is none like you.
Good morning and welcome to our worship service today. I'm Alan Akana, the kahu or pastor of Kaloa Union Church, and it's so good to see everyone here today. I know that we've got a lot of people traveling, and we will pray for travel mercies for all of them and any of you that may be traveling in the upcoming weeks as well. I did want to point out these beautiful flowers here on the communion table and also on the flower stand are in memory of Lucy Sabalos. Lucy's celebration of life was yesterday, and many of you know Lucy. She came here, attended worship services fairly regularly before the pandemic, and Lucy, of course, is Rose Tatiana's mother-in-law. So we sent her off yesterday and celebrated her life, and it was a really special time. And we will continue to pray for the family, who will miss her greatly for many days to come. I do welcome any guests that are here today, and if you are here for the first time, we do have a welcome packet for you, and we are no longer collecting an offering. So if you've been especially blessed by our time together and would like to leave an offering, you can do so in the offering bowl right here or the offering basket right outside the main doors, and you can always give online as well. And on page 5 of our bulletin, it tells you how to do that. Couple just really brief announcements. Coming up tonight is youth group at the Parsonage. So the youth will be arriving about 4:45 today. And we'll be feeding them and playing some games and talking a little bit about our theme of blossoming this coming year. And then also for those of you that would like to join us for breakfast, on Tuesday is our all-church breakfast. And you're more than welcome to come to Keawe Roots up on the highway in Lawai. And it's just a time for me and anyone else who wants to gather just to come and have a meal together. If you are going to come, we like to let the restaurant know ahead of time, you know, how many chairs to save for us. And we do have a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board right outside the main doors. And also, just to make sure things go as smoothly as possible, if you would like to order ahead of time, you can do that. I think you can call or go online and just take care of that so the food will be ready when you get there. You can also, like I do often, just order once you get there, and it doesn't take that long. And then I also wanted to point out that Penny Osuga, our administrative assistant, is taking a little bit of vacation time for the next couple of weeks. And so we will not have regular office hours here at the church. I'll be here on and off as usual. But if you need anything in particular, you can leave a message on the church answering machine or just call me directly. And we will take care of whatever your needs are in the next couple of weeks. And of course, my phone number is on the very back of the bulletin. And then the other announcement that I have is that next week will be a very special Sunday. It will be World Communion Sunday. And many of you know that last month I was at the Parliament of the World's Religions, and I feel just very passionately that it's important to remind ourselves that we are all connected here in this world together, regardless of what particular church or denomination or even religion you're a part of. It's also the day that we will collect the Neighbors in Need offering. And that's one of our four United Church of Christ special offerings that we take every single year. And you'll see in your bulletin, we have an insert that talks about a couple of young environmentalists from a UCC church in New Jersey and what they're doing for the environment. And that's part of the emphasis this year. For 2023, the Neighbors in Need emphasis is on environmental justice. It's always about justice and compassion. But I was thrilled to hear that that was our theme this year. Earlier in the summer, our youth and the youth from Central Union Church from Oahu got together and cleaned up Salt Pond Beach and learned a little bit about the importance of taking care of the environment. I'm also reading a book right now on environmental justice. And during the Parliament of the World's Religions, that was a huge theme as well. Just the importance for all of us to figure out ways to take better care of the planet. And so next week, you'll have the opportunity to give towards that. And the Neighbors in Need offering envelopes will be in your bulletins next week. And for those of you that won't be here, or if you're watching online, you can always just go onto the church website donation page and just write N-I-N or Neighbors in Need. And you can also write that on any check that you want to send in. And we'll make sure that that goes, 100% of that goes to the Neighbors in Need offering. Well, today we are going to look at what the scriptures say about how we treat the poor and how we treat the underprivileged in our society. And so as we begin today's worship service, I would like for you to think about ways that you treat the poor and the underprivileged and opportunities to make a difference in the world in terms of poor and underprivileged people, and think about who some of those people are in our society. I also would like for you to think about ways that our church and the United Church of Christ serves the poor and underprivileged in ways that we might be better at that. And then, and I don't think this will be too much of a challenge, but ways that our nation can be better at serving people who are underprivileged, people on the margins of society, and people who are poor. So think about that for just a moment as we begin today's worship service.
Good morning. Today's call to worship is from Psalm 105. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon God's name. Make God's deeds known among all people. Sing to the Lord. Sing praises to God. Proclaim all of God's wonderful works. Give glory to God's holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord. Seek the strength of the Lord. Seek God's presence always. Remember the wonderful works that the Lord has done for us. Remember all of God's miracles and words. Let us pray. O God, we offer to you our praise and thanksgiving. We sing praises to you and rejoice in your presence. As we give thanks for all of our blessings, remind us of the importance of sharing them with others. Remind us especially of those who are poor and those who are suffering. May your love flow through us into the lives of all. Amen.
It announces the next song is Kia Kua Mana E. You recognize it.
Mm-hmm.
nani kama ha'o nano ihana kahonua ne mena hoku kau ila kahe kili hoike ana iko mana e he mele au ika ho ola e nani no he nani no he mele a ika ho ola e he nani no consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Yes, I know you treat me kind, Lord, I know you are all I dreamed of. Give me joy and happiness, but above all, you give me love, and I of you. I will always love you.
Today's Old Testament reading is from the prophet Amos, chapter 8, verses 4 through 7. Listen for the word of God. Hear this, you who trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah smaller and the shekel heavier and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of these deeds. Today's gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. Listen for the word of God. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, you also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right. So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, why are you standing here idle all day? They said to him, because no one has hired us. He said to them, you also go into the vineyard. When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to the manager, call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first. When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received a denarius. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the denarius. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, these last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us for the who borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. But he replied to one of them, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this the last the same as I gave to you. Am I not allowed to give what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I'm generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last. May God bless the reading of the word, and may our hearts be open to receiving it.
To say that today's parable in Matthew chapter 20 is one of the strangest, I think, of Jesus' parables, and I also think it's one of the most difficult to understand. It's frankly a bit troubling for me as I read it, and when you read it out of context, it almost sounds like, you know, it's okay just to put in as little time as possible to get the most out of life. And, you know, it's okay that, you know, people can just sort of get through life getting as much as they can at the expense of others. And, you know, it's an interesting parable, but Jesus is basically saying, you know, those who work really hard aren't going to get as much out of life as those who just put very little into it. And so as I read it out of context, there's all sorts of questions that come into my mind. But then when I think about this parable in the context of both what was happening in the world during that time and the context of Jesus' overall message, it makes a lot more sense to me. And what was going on in the world was that everybody in that time lived in the Roman Empire, and most people, close to 90% of the people, were poor. And almost everybody didn't own any land that they lived on or worked on. And most people suffered. Most people lived very short lives with a lot of pain and a lot of illness and a lot of hunger as well. And then there was the small handful of people who actually were the landowners, and, you know, they had enough food to feed their families. The poor people got a denarius, and a denarius is like a penny or two, which would just about cover what you needed to feed your family for the day, with nothing left over, except, of course, to pay your taxes. Well, those who owned land actually could amass a little bit of wealth, sometimes a lot of wealth, and they basically determined what the lives would be like for all the rest of the people, at least to a certain degree. Because then you had the elite, you know, maybe 2% of the entire population, who owned almost everything and who were in control. And one of the things that they controlled was the messaging of the empire. And one of the messages was that the way things were was all ordained by God. And you are not to question the way things are, economically, culturally, politically, because to question the way things are meant that you were questioning the emperor, and to question the emperor meant that you were actually questioning God. And that is just completely abhorrent. You can't question. That's the context of what people lived like in those days. But the context of Jesus' message was that Jesus looked at that messaging and not only questioned it, but outright condemned it. And he did so in his teaching, and he did so in his life. Jesus came along and basically looked at all that the Roman Empire stood for and presented an alternative, an empire that he called the Empire of God, or in Matthew, the Empire of Heaven. So Matthew says the Empire of God once in a while, but typically changes Jesus' words to the Empire of Heaven, unlike Mark and Luke. So anyway, since we're talking about Matthew, I'm going to refer to the Empire of Heaven, because even though many of our translations in English today say the Kingdom of Heaven, Jesus was comparing the Roman Empire to God's dream of an altogether different kind of empire. And frankly, it's the same word in the Greek language, which the New Testament was written in, the Empire of Rome and the Empire of Heaven. Same word. So I'm going to refer to what we normally say, the Kingdom of God or the Kingdom of Heaven, as the Empire of Heaven, because that's how it would have landed on people back then. Those people who heard Jesus say those words, or the people who first read them in the Gospel of Matthew. So what was the Empire of Heaven? What's the context there? Well, Jesus came along and said, everybody has value. Every human life has value. And he questioned the structure of the Roman Empire, which said the elite people have the most value. Their lives are more valuable than anyone else's. And then those who were kind of the landowners, the more wealthy people, their lives have maybe not as much value as the elite, but way more value than the great masses of people. And then the poorest of the poor people virtually had no value. That was the messaging of the empire. And Jesus came along and said, no, every single person has value, regardless of whether you're rich or poor. Doesn't matter what class you belong to, your life has just as much value as anybody else's. And so knowing that context, let's look at this parable for just a moment, where Jesus tells the story of a landowner who hired a group of workers first thing in the morning, probably between 6 and 7. He's waiting and he looks around and thinks, okay, I've got this vineyard and I need these people working in it. I'm going to pick the people I think that would be the most valuable to me. So he picks a group of them and they start working right about the time the sun comes up. And they agree to work for a denarius. Again, just a penny or two, enough money to buy bread for your family for one day and to pay your taxes, really with nothing left over. And so these people are out sweating, working in the vineyard all day long, sun up to sundown. Well, in the story, the parable, Jesus also goes out and talks to the next group about 9 in the morning and says, well, I want to hire you, because he's basically thinking this group that I've hired over here isn't going to get the job done on time that I need to get done. So I'm going to hire some more people at 9 o'clock. And then around noon, he realizes, well, that's not going to do it either. I need to hire some more people because we got to get this. We got to get the grapes picked. So anyway, noon, he does it again. 3 o'clock, he does it again. And then about 5 o'clock or so, he goes back and he knows that the sun's going to set pretty soon. But he thinks, oh, if I just hire a few more people to work for just an hour or so, we can get enough done. And then it comes time to pay everybody. So the people that show up at 5 o'clock, he gives them their denarius. And the people in line behind him are all thinking, oh, well, we're going to get more. Well, the people that showed up at 3 o'clock, they get a denarius, all the way down to the people who've been working all day long. And they got the same amount as the people who worked an hour or less. And so they complain. And the landowner basically says, it's up to me to decide, you know, who I pay what. By the way, don't forget, you agreed ahead of time to work for a denarius. So that's the story, but now that you've heard a little bit of the context, both cultural and political and economic, as well as the comparison that Jesus was all about, comparing the Empire of Rome to the Empire of Heaven, let's take a closer look at this parable. So one thing I want you to know is that just because there's a main character in the parable that's in charge doesn't mean that character represents God. So all the parables have a point, or at least one point, sometimes one major point, sometimes maybe a couple. But the point is to show what the kingdom of heaven is like compared to, or the Empire of Heaven compared to the Empire of Rome. And so you've got this main character who is actually very stingy. He owns lots of land. This person doesn't ever have any trouble feeding his family. And yet, he gives people who've been working all day long just barely enough to get by. And the idea is he can afford more. But because he can get away with giving as little as possible, that's what he does. And frankly, that's not God, is it? And so I want you to keep in mind is just because there's a main character in a parable that Jesus is telling doesn't mean that Jesus is saying this is God or this person represents God. So we have to kind of get that out of our mind right away, because here we've got somebody that's actually very stingy. And all that Jesus has been talking about and teaching is how generous God is, how we live in this abundant world where there's enough for everybody to thrive and not just barely get by. So this can't possibly be a God figure. Besides, this figure's not, this main character, the landowner of the vineyard, the the owner, just simply isn't very fair to the rest, and he's not very sensitive either. And so as I read everything in Matthew's gospel that talks about God, I'm thinking, this is not God. So keep that in mind. And also, when we read the parable, sometimes we think, the lesson's so obvious. And sometimes we think that this particular lesson is about the fact that those who make a lot more money because they're able to, whether it's because they're physically fit or healthy, we think from reading the parable that Jesus is condemning them. And yet, that's really not what the parable's doing either. So it's not really about the fairness or the unfairness of those who have the potential to do better in life and to make more money. So if it's not about God being the main character being God, and it's not about the unfairness of those that have the potential to rise further to the top, what's the parable really about? And when you read the whole parable in context of what's going on in the empire and all of Jesus' teaching about the kingdom of heaven, it seems really clear that the message of this parable is that God cares very deeply for those who are part of the empire. Everyone. Especially and including those who are at the very bottom. So if you think about somebody who is chosen last, you think about somebody who is asked to work at 5 o'clock rather than at 7 or 8 in the morning, these are the people who typically get asked last to do anything. I was reminded of elementary school when you pick sides, and there's always the kids that are chosen last. And I remember early on when I used to do youth ministry, I said, I will never choose sides for teams that way, because there's always somebody that feels really bad for getting picked last. And it's usually the same kids, the same people. And so in the parable, you've got these people that are always feeling like, I'm always picked last. I'm either worthless or have the least amount of value as anybody else around. And so this parable is actually saying everybody has value. Every single person. And how we treat the poor, the people that are typically picked last, says more about how we express our love for God than just about anything else that we do. So you can love lots of people, but if you treat the poor very poorly, then you're not really loving God very well. Now, that might be a hard thing for some people to say, to hear if they don't care about the poor, but that's the whole point. The poor people and the underprivileged people in our societies are just as valuable to God as anybody else, and they should be just as valuable to us. Now, another thing I want to point out is Jesus really wasn't saying anything new. And that's really important for me to say, because a lot of times people think, well, Jewish culture must be very selfish. And it wasn't until Jesus came along that the Jewish people said, oh, okay, so we need to take care of poor people now. No, the case is that in Jewish history, in their tradition, taking care of the poor and valuing the poor was always really important. And if you look at the Old Testament passage that we read today in Amos chapter 8, we see Amos the prophet saying just that. In fact, the way he does it, if you read the first several chapters of Amos, what he actually does, and this is like a brilliant literary way of capturing people's attention, he's speaking to the people of Israel. And he starts pointing out all the sins of all their enemies all around them. And you can almost hear them see them nodding their heads and saying in agreement, yep, they deserve bad stuff from God. Look how immoral they are. Look how violent they are. They're horrible people, all those enemies. And so Amos starts, in the first opening chapters of the book, starts listing all the enemies of Israel and how God is so displeased and they should be judged. And the Israelites are going, yes, they need to be judged and they need to be judged and they need to be judged and they need to be judged. And then all of a sudden Amos says, and now you. You're worse than all of them. And that must have been a shock to them to hear that, but the main thing that they did wrong was they didn't value the poor people in their society. They treated the poor horribly. They had slaves. They treated poor people and the underprivileged as if they had no value whatsoever. They lied to them. They cheated them. They didn't give them what they deserved. They were just completely selfish. So the people who had the power in Israel at that time were missing the whole point. And Amos was saying, just like you believe that all these people around you should be judged for all their sins, you're worse than them because of the way you treat the poor in your society. And so as I hear that message and think about what Jesus was saying, the poor people are just as valuable as everyone else in our society. And as I look at Amos and all the prophets of the Old Testament saying the same thing, we must also today love and care for the poor and underprivileged people in our society. And that goes for our church, our denomination, and our country as well. And you know, there's a movement abroad in this country that basically says, you know, we really should not pay attention to how we've treated the underprivileged in the past, or today for that matter. In fact, we don't want books to be read in classrooms or have in libraries that children might read about the sins of our past. But you know, isn't that exactly what Amos was doing? Isn't that what Jesus was doing? If you read through the book of Amos, he was pointing out the sins of the nation's past and saying, repent. And by repent, he basically, what that meant was change the way you are being in the world. Change the way you see things. Change the way you're doing things. And frankly, unless you look at what's wrong, you don't know what to change. And so my concern in our country today is when we tell people, well, we don't want children reading those books. That's kind of embarrassing. Or we're just going to deny some of these things. And I'm talking about how our country from the get-go treated the indigenous people of these lands. And I'm talking about all of North America and Hawaii as well. I'm talking about the way that our country has traditionally treated people from Africa, people of African descent, and how they are continued to be treated today. In fact, I'm thinking about immigrants throughout our nation's history. Whoever the most recent immigrants are typically treated the poorest. And then you can consider people who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and so forth. Throughout our nation's history, people have been treated very poorly because of who they are, where they came from, or what they believe, especially if they're any different from the status quo. And my concern really is if we don't look at our past and see what we've done wrong, we won't know what to change in order to heal ourselves as a country. We cannot just keep closing our eyes and saying we're going to pretend like it doesn't exist because we don't want to feel uncomfortable about our past and we don't want our children to feel uncomfortable about our past. We need to take a look at the sins of our country, the sins of our church as well, and we have to be able to say we don't want that to happen anymore. What will it take to change those things? So think about for a moment, what are the things that you see in our society today that are based on things that we've done in the past as a country, possibly as a denomination, as the Christian church as a whole or whatever? What are some things that we have done that we need to take a look at and say, not only do we need to look at them, but how can we do things differently? How can we repent? How can we see things differently? How can we be different people so that the kingdom of heaven, as Jesus talked about it, will truly be a part of who we are moving forward? May God bless us as we do so.
This next song is called Fall Like Rain. We've done this before. But like Kahu was saying, you know, the rain is for everyone, not for a few privileged people. God, I live to worship you. All my life I offer you. Simple melodies of sacrifice. Open hands and open heart. You're the only one I want. Your presence is my treasure, my delight. Fall like rain, Holy Spirit, fall like rain. Holy Spirit, have your way. Let your glory fall down, let your glory fall down. One thing I ask, one thing I seek, so much more than anything, to dwell within your house for all my days. Knowing you is everything, so I let go of lesser things. You alone are worthy of my praise. Stir in me a passion for your name. Fall like rain, Holy Spirit, fall like rain. Holy Spirit, have your way. Let your glory fall down, let your glory fall down. Fall like rain, Holy Spirit, fall like rain. Holy Spirit, have your way. Let your glory fall down, let your glory fall down. May I always stand in awe of who you are. Oh, the beauty and the gift of your love, Lord, is unlike anything I've ever known. May I never lose the wonder of your presence. May I always stand in awe of who you are. Oh, the beauty and the gift of your love, Lord, is unlike anything I've ever known. Fall like rain, Holy Spirit, fall like rain. Holy Spirit, have your your glory fall down, let your glory fall down. Fall like rain, Holy Spirit, fall like rain. Holy Spirit, have your way. Let your glory fall down, let your glory fall down.
like rain.
Thank you so much, Rose Tatiana and Doug, for that beautiful melee and hula. And now it's time for the prayers of the people. And I think we have a card or two, maybe more. While Joanne's coming up, I would just remind you that on page 7 of the bulletin, we have the prayers that we pray for during the week. And I invite you to pray for all the requests that are on there. And then also let us know through filling out one of these cards or contacting the church office if there's anything else that you would like for us to pray for. So starting off with some sad news, the Reverend Art Mample passed away. He's a former pastor from here. He served this church from 1970 to 1978. So pray for Jackie, his wife, and their children. And then this is from Don and Sharon, grateful for a wonderful trip to Colorado and recovered from COVID, recovering, so very good. And then for Elizabeth, God does move in mysterious ways. On Thursday, I traveled to Montclair, New Jersey to celebrate my 50th high school reunion. That just seems impossible, but anyway, so travel mercies for Elizabeth. And Bonnie's asking for prayers for Enoka Baklion, who has pancreatic cancer. So as we begin to pray, let us offer our joys as well as any unspoken concerns to God. And after a moment of silent prayer, I'll lead us in a verbal prayer. Let us pray together. Holy God, we thank you for the many blessings in our lives and for the joys that we carry with us. We thank you especially for time spent with family and loved ones and opportunities to travel to be with people. And we do pray for safety and your travel mercies for all who are traveling on this day and this week. We thank you also for those who have experienced healing and for those who have been comforted both physically and emotionally. And God, we also know that there are those among us who are struggling with illness and injury, those with diseases, and we pray especially for those who have COVID, for Enoka, and then we also pray for those who have recently lost loved ones, for the family of Lucy Sabalos, and also the family of Reverend Art Mample. God, you know that there are others, many others, who have recently passed, and there are people in our midst and those we love who are saddened and grieving, and we pray that you be with them in their grief. We also pray for good memories that will sustain us, memories of life, of relationship, of love. And God, we also think of today, especially those who are poor, those who are underprivileged. May we as individuals and as a church, as a denomination and as a nation continue to reach out to people who are struggling, but may we also, may we also be mindful as we vote and as we make policies and as our leaders make policies and decisions about how to care for those who are underprivileged. May they be filled with both compassion and wisdom. And God, as we think of those who have been devastated recently from fires and floods and earthquakes and so many other natural disasters throughout the world, we pray for your peace and for recovery and for places like Ukraine where there continues to be warfare. We pray for peace and an end to the violence. And God, for places where there are injustices of all kinds, we pray for not only peace and comfort, but justice for all people. And God, finally, we know that there are those whom we love, whose lives are winding down, and especially those who are in hospice care. We pray for them, O God, that you would comfort them at whatever stage they are in life, whether they have days or weeks or months or even years left. We pray that they would be so ever mindful of your loving presence. O God, we pray all of these things in the name of our faithful Savior, Jesus, who taught us to pray by saying together, Our Creator, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now I invite you to take the Tan hymnal, Nahi Meni. Turn to hymn number 133. We will sing together, O Loko Mai Ka'i He Nani No, which is Amazing Grace. You'll recognize the tune. And we will just be singing verses 1 and 4. So let us stand as we sing together. May the love of God, the grace of our Savior Jesus, and the comfort and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us and with all people now and forever. Amen. Peace of God be with you. And let us greet one another with the peace of God.